than a year after the French colonization of Algeria, around 1831, the German scholar Wilhelm Schimper traveled to Algeria to study some specific plants. But when he returned to his country, he felt he needed first to write a book about Algeria and its people. His book relates the stories of Algerians and their lives, their cleanliness, and their education. He mentioned they would perform ablution and perform prayers regularly, and that their women were modest and shy. Overall, a lot of details on their lives that will give you a good picture how the Algerians were living during that time. But we extract one expression from the book that we will use as an introduction to our topic today. Schimper said, "I couldn't find in Algeria anyone who is not good in reading and writing, but instead, some of whom I met spoke Arabic, French, English, Spanish, Italian, and they memorized the Quran, and I found some Algerians who knew Europe city by city, which surprised me. In Europe, it's rare that you find commoners who knew how to read and write." Schimper's testimony should be memorized by our youth today, as in France's official speeches, it is always mentioned that it is they that brought civilization to Algeria. Let's start our discussion with this period where Schimper witnessed the culture and the knowledge of the Algerians during the 19th century. We go back in time to the 12th century, where we find around the Mediterranean Sea four beacons of knowledge, none of whom were in the hands of the Europeans. They were Cordoba in Andalusia, Tlemcen, Marrakesh, and Bejaia. Around that time, there was an Italian merchant from what was called the Republic of Pisa, working in trade between Pisa and Bejaia. He would take his son Leonardo with him, as he wanted him to have a bright future in business. But when he saw the difference in culture, knowledge, trust, and science between Europe and the people of Bejaia, he decided to leave his son in Bejaia in one of the schools of knowledge, so he may benefit from their teachers and learn the good manners from the people. The son, Leonardo Fibonacci, said that his father was a wealthy man. He rented out a good house for him in Bejaia, and he would wander during afternoons in its beautiful streets, watching the clown play with monkeys. He loved the people, the food, and the beach there. He said that he joined the circle of knowledge of Sheikh Boumedien, then Abu Hamid al-Saghir's circle, and then he had the honor to become the student of the scholar Abu al-Haq al-Ishbili. He was amazed by their knowledge, and more amazed by the Arabic numerals 1, 2, 3, and their use in mathematical calculations. In Europe, they would count 1, 2, 3, and 4, and then proceed with the Roman numerals, where this is 1, and 2, and 3, and 4, and 5. If we take 77, for example, see how big it'll become. This was difficult for use for addition and subtraction, let alone multiplication, division, and equations. Before I finish with this, let me give you an example on how the Europeans were counting before they learned the Arabic numerals from Bejaia. This is 79 plus 134. See how lengthy the result is. Then they turn 5 I's into a V, 2 V's into an X, 5 X's to an L, and 2 L's to a C to get the final result. However, with Arabic numerals, you can add big numbers easily, and this is an example of what the Arabic numbers provided to mathematical writing. Look how the number is written in Arabic numerals and how it's written in Roman numerals. And what was strange to him is that he found with the Arabs a specific symbol from the number 0, which was not known to the Europeans and was never considered in their mathematical calculations. Leonardo got very excited with what he learned, and he decided to return to Europe instead of staying in Bejaia to teach people the numbers and equations to drive them away from their cumbersome calculations with Roman numerals, because he was able, from what he learned in Bejaia, to write in the one line what Europeans were writing in a whole page. And indeed, he returned to his country and wrote a book on the Arabic numerals and how to use them in mathematical calculations. He tried showing it to some mathematicians of his time. Some were pleased by the book, some didn't understand its concepts, and some were even convinced that this circular symbol of zero is a symbol of Satan. However, he isolated himself and continued to use the Arabic numerals he learned in Bejaia, until he developed new mathematical equations, some of them, bearing his name, still amazed people and are still used today. Years after his discussions with traders and writers and accountants, he was able to convince people that mathematics are easier and more productive when using Arabic numerals, so these symbols spread little by little in Italy, then in Europe, then throughout the entire world. The Roman numerals became obsolete, and the Arabic numerals started being used up to this very day. All this is explained in detail in the book The Arab Sun Shines Over the West by the author Sigrid Honka. I hope this adds some value to your historic knowledge.